So we all know that our God is a God who knows everything about us. There is nothing that you can probably hide from Him. So there is no shame in declaring and in confessing to God what you're going through. And sometimes we keep it to ourselves until and unless we reach that point where you turn to God. So, but our relationship is not as such. Our relationship is such that even the smallest and the silliest thing, we speak to God and we treat Him like our Father, our best friend, and share everything with Him. Amen. So, whatever we are going through,
hallelujah,
all that we can do is to happily share with Him and lay that burden down.
Amen.
And tell, Lord, I come to Your presence no matter what. Because in the bad times, in the good times, I will always praise You.
Amen.
So the song that we're going to sing is, Lord, I trade my sorrows, I trade my sickness, I trade my pain, because I know it's all covered by Your love, Your grace. And there's nothing else that can replace that particular love. Amen. Let's all sing and worship the Lord from the bottom of our hearts. Amen. Yes, Lord. I'm trading my sorrows.
Now I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Now I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
And we say yes, Lord.
Say yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Oppressed
but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond a curse, for His promise will endure.
Just gonna be my strength.
Though the sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness,
I'm trading my pain.
Joy of the laying them down on the joy of the
and
Lord.
And we declare,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Once again, we declare, yes, Lord, everything.
We sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Oppressed
but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. Blessed beyond a curse, for His promise will endure. His joy is gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may
last for the night, joy comes in the morning.
I'm trading my sorrow,
I'm trading my sorrow,
I'm trading my shame,
I'm trading my shame.
I'm laying them down
for the joy of the laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down joy of the laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Let's sing it one more, one last time, come on.
Sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
Psalms 55 is basically a cry of David to the Lord, and he says, verses 6 onwards, I said, oh, that I had the wings of a dove.
Amen.
I would fly away and be at rest.
Amen.
I would flee far away and stay in the desert. I would hurry to my place of shelter, far away from the tempest and the storm. And then he said, evening and morning and noon, I cry out in distress, and he hears my voice. He rescues me unharmed from the battle waged against me, even though many oppose me. Amen. Pray God that as we sing this song, Father, that we remember that even in the worst storms of our lives, God, we can praise you, Father, and then we can worship you.
Yes,
you listen to our cries, God.
This is my prayer in the fires, in weakness or trial or pain. There is a faith proved of more worth than gold, so refine me, Lord, through the flame.
And I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is in.
This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm in His promise I stand. Now I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. I will bring praise, I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is
season. You are still God. I have reason to sing. Every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice. I will declare God is my victory and He is here. I will bring praise. I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice. I will declare God is my victory and He is here.
This is my prayer in the harvest when favor and providence flow. I know I'm filled to be emptied again. The seed I've received, I will sow. Even when the fight seems lost, I praise you. Even when it hurts, like help, I'll praise you. Even when it makes no sense to sing louder than I'll sing your praise, I will only sing your praise, Lord. Is lost, I'll praise you. Even when I have no song, I'll praise you. Even when it's hard to find the words, louder than I'll sing your praise. I'll only sing your praise.
Tremble, Jesus,
Jesus.
You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus,
Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Your name is alive, that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome.
Is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your
darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Silence fear, Jesus, Jesus.
Lord. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Silence fear.
Jesus. Even when my strength is lost, I pray. And it's hard to find the words louder than I sing your praise. I will only sing your praise. And even when the morning comes,
I'll praise you. Even when my fight is won,
yes, Lord. I'll
continue to praise you, God.
Yes. Even when my time on earth is done, louder than I'll sing your praise. I will only sing your praise, God. I will only sing your praise, your praise, Jesus.
I will only sing your praise. Season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing.
Yes, Lord, I have a reason always to sing.
I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. I will bring praise. I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here.
I will bring praise,
I will bring praise, no weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here.
One last time.
I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here.
God is my victory and He is here. Shepherd of our soul, my Lord.
Amen, Jesus.
Lord,
We give you everything, O Master. All control to you, O Lord, because you are a master. Yes, Lord, help us, Lord, to listen to your voice this morning, O Lord. Yes, Lord. As we sing this next song, let's just lift our hands. Commit to God and say, Lord, you are the shepherd of my soul. Yes. Yes, Lord. Wherever you go, I will follow. I'll follow your word, O Master, no matter what.
Amen. Yes, Lord, Father God.
Thank you, Jesus. Of my soul, I give you full control. Wherever you may lay, I will follow. I have made a choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lay, I will go. Shepherd of my soul.
Shepherd of my soul, I give you full control. Wherever you may lead, I will follow. I have made the choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lead, I will go. Quiet pasture, run by a gentle stream. The shepherd of my soul is by my side. Should I face a mighty mountain or a valley dark and deep, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide. My soul, I give you full control. Wherever you may lead, I will follow. I have made the choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lead, I will go.
Be it in the
choir. Gentle stream, the shepherd of my soul is by my side. Should I face a mighty mountain or a valley dark and deep, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide. In a quiet pasture, run by a gentle stream, the shepherd of my soul is by my side. Should I face a mighty mountain, nor a valley dark and deep, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide.
Holy Spirit, come down. Come down today, O Lord. Yes.
You're my God.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. for this amazing time of worship that you've given us.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we always long to worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let the Holy Spirit fill this place today.
Thank you, Lord. Give it
praise. Open the floodgates, O Master. We believe. We believe. Thank you. Commit the time into your hands, Master. Yes, Lord. Lord, it's not us but you, O Jesus. We give everything unto you, O Lord. We surrender hearts to you, O Lord. Yes, Lord. Take control, Master. As we commit the time into your hands that are coming, Lord, even the communion and the message, I pray, Lord, that there be your presence. Because we don't want to leave without your presence, O Master. Lord, fill our hearts. In Jesus' wonderful and beautiful name I pray.
Amen.
What is the will of God? We always say, will of God, will of God. Can you tell me what is the will of God? People define like this, the will of God is that which He approves and determines to bring about. God approves certain things. God has a determination to bring certain things into reality. So, the will of God is that which He approves and determines to bring about. That's all about the will of God. And we know God is sovereign and He is in control of everything, and He wants to see that His will is carried out throughout the world. And before we get into the, you know, some of the practical aspect to the will of God, I want to just share some of the distinctions that we make about the will of God. Different types of will of God. And first of all, I want to take you to the sovereign will of God or predestined will of God. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 11 says, God has predestined will of God. This is all about the will of God that He wanted to carry forward in this world. And nothing can stop this will of God. God determined, God ordained, and God decreed this will of God. Nobody can change this will of God. This is a sovereign and predestined will of God. Before even everything was created, God had this will in His mind. And secondly, we have revealed will of God and secret will of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse number 29 says, the secret things belongs to God, but revealed things belongs to us. So there are certain things God never revealed to us. That those are the secret will of God. And there are things God revealed to us that is revealed will of God. And we all know in the Bible, we can see the revealed will of God. God has certain commandments to each one of us, how we need to live, what kind of moral life we need, what kind of choice that we need to make. God has certain commandments. Those commandments were revealed in the Bible, in the scripture. So we have revealed will of God. And let me just tell you, revealed will of God, we need to follow. And if we don't follow the revealed will of God, what happened? We will face consequences. God clearly revealed His will that, you know, people of God, Adam and Eve should not eat the fruit of that particular tree. But they violated that will of God and they had to face the consequences. Similarly, and we have this revealed will of God in the scripture, and if we violate, we will face the consequences of those, you know, disobediences. And the third, the type of will of God is God's desired will. God's desired will. And we know God has certain desires for every one of us. All of us. You know, God has certain desires. Especially when we are born again. The right from the day one, God has certain desires for us. We all are, some of us are parents. And when our child is born to a family, parents have certain desires. Right? The similar way, all of us, God has a desire for all of us. And for example, I can tell you in Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 3, it says, you know, sanctification, our holiness is God's will. It's God's desire. Every born again child should have sanctification. This is God's desire for every one of us. And also in the 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, again, you know, God wants to see that we all thank God in every circumstances in our life. That's God's will. So that's God's desire. Even in the midst of struggles and suffering and challenges and joyful occasion, God wants to see that God's desire is that we need to praise Him, thank Him in everything. And we know if you read Galatians chapter 5, it says that the spirit has desires and the flesh has a desire. A born-again believer is expected to live in the desires of Spirit of God, desires of God. Hallelujah. So God's desired will. And I want to encourage you, dear chum, we are called to, you know, please God. When we do God's will, His desires, it just bring happiness to God's heart. It pleases God. And then fourthly, God has a personal will for every one of us. All of us. I'm going to more or less focus on this point in the rest of the sermon. God has a personal desire, personal will for every one of us. Amen. And this personal will of God has probably three different aspects. First of all, God has intentions for every one of us. Before even we were born on this earth, God has a clear intentions, plans and purposes for every one of us. And Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 1:5, God told to Jeremiah them, before he was formed in the mother's womb, you know, God consecrated him. God appointed him as a prophet to the nation. So either similar thing you can see in Galatians, Paul talks, before he was born, God's call was upon him for an apostolic ministry. Dear church, remember this thing. Before even we were born on this earth, God has a clear plan for our life. God has a clear plan about even our vocation, what kind of job we need to do. And not only that, if you read Psalms number 139, verse number 16 and 17, then it clearly says, all our days are numbered and planned and written in God's book. So before even we were born on this earth, God counted the days that we live on this earth. And the Bible says here, He planned all those days. Amen. So God has a plan for how long we need to live and how we should live on every day, you know, on this earth. And if you continuously read, continuously explore, Acts chapter 17 verse number 26 says, God decided where, which nation we should be born. God decided where we should live. Don't think you are an accident in Bangalore. Don't think that you are an accident to your parents. No, it is God's clear plan and purpose that you are born on that particular family where you born and particular place that you are living today. It is God's own plan for each one of us. So God has clear intentions for us. I brought some examples about vocation, number of days we live, how we live each day, where we will live, which nation we will live. All these things are God's clear intention for each one of us. But sometimes, so we all know now, God has intentions for us. God has personal will for each one of us. But sometimes we mess up with these intentions of God. The personal will of God. We don't clearly listen to Him. We don't take time to wait and understand God's will. We don't discern His directions rightly in our life. What happened to us? We will mess up sometime. Or sometimes God clearly says to us, talk to us His will, but we don't follow Him. We won't obey Him. And then we will mess up with God's right will for us. God's will for us. And one of the examples for that is Jonah. Jonah was asked to go to Nineveh. But where he went? He went to Tarsus, right? And a great storm came upon that ship. And his life was in danger, and those ship people threw him out of ship. And in that scene, what he did, he cried to the Lord. He asked the Lord, save my life. Help me, Lord. And God is a God of mercy and compassion. And God, in his kindness, listened to Jonah, brought him back to the purposes of God, brought him back to the will of God, and then he could complete the ministry in Nineveh. So when we mess up, sometimes God allows us to have circumstantial will of God in our life. Situations-based will of God. Situation-based guidance over us. He reveals those kind of solutions to us to simply express his grace and kindness and love to each one of us. That doesn't mean that we will not face the consequences for our disobedience. Jonah faced some consequences of his disobedience. Certain times God will not give us the consequences. Certain times he gives us consequences in our life for our disobediences in our life. So I want to encourage you, dear church, do not mess up with God's intentions, God's will for your life. And James talks of, sometimes we all think, oh God, I missed God's will in my life. I had so many years, I missed God's will. I never asked you what kind of profession I should do, what kind of ministry I should involve. I didn't ask you many things. I took my own decision. I want to encourage you, do not regret about past mistakes. Do not regret about those opportunities though that you missed to follow God's will. James chapter 4, verse number 13 onwards says very clearly, God has a will for tomorrow in our life. If you read that passage, we are not allowed, expected to say that tomorrow or today I will go to that city, I will start a business there, and I will make a profit. He is not expecting us to say something like that. Rather, he is expecting us to say that if it is God's will, then we will leave and do this or that. So he is clearly says for tomorrow, God has a will for your life. So what we need to do? We need to recognize that, discern that, and live for that. Let me tell you, dear church, God has a personal will for each one of us. Before even we were born on this earth, God has intentions for us, intentional will for us. And if we mess up, God allows us to have circumstantial will and follow his path, obey him, come back to him, and then for tomorrow, we have a great opportunity to understand God's will and follow God's will in our personal life. Why this is important? Why following God's will is important in our life? Why this is a serious matter? I want to bring 6 reasons from the Bible why the will of God is so important in our personal life. First of all, every born-again believer needs to live for the will of God. And 1 Peter chapter 4 verse number 2 says very clearly, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passion, but for the will of God. Before we were born again, we were living according to the passions of this world, according to the sins of this world. But once we are born again, we are not supposed to live according to the desires of this world or desires of the flesh. Rather, we are expected to live according to the will of God. So the sole purpose of born again life is to please God, to do God's will. Hallelujah. So dear brothers and sisters, please listen very carefully. If you are born again, you are responsible to live according to the will of God, to find out the will of. Listen very carefully. When you are born again, your spirit is born again. Your spirit came alive. And Bible very clearly says in Romans chapter 8 and Ephesians chapter 2, many other places, the Spirit of God dwells in us and he speaks to our spirit. So now born again believers have a spiritual capacity to listen God's will, hear his voice, discern his will, and listen very carefully. We all have this internal compass that God has given to recognize God's leading in our life, God's directions in our life, God's guidance in our life. That's why every born again believer is responsible to live according to the will of God. We don't have any excuse, because when you are born again, God supernaturally equipped each one of us to listen his voice, listen his direction, recognize his will. So I want to encourage you, we should live according to the will of God. And the second reason, This is the principle of life that Jesus himself showed us. And Hebrew chapter 10 verse number 7 says like this. Then I said, behold, I have come to your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scrolls of the book. It's very clearly says, behold, I have come to do your will, O God. Jesus appeared on this earth to do God's will. What was the purpose, ultimate purpose of his life? To do God's will. He showed us example. Every born again believer, every follower of God should follow the will of God and do his will. We are born on this earth to serve God's purposes and his will, dear children. So even this Jesus had tremendous desire, tremendous commitment, tremendous determination to do God's will. And that determination and desire and purpose is manifested in his prayer in Gethsemane. Matthew chapter 26 verse number 38 says like, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus is praying in a crucial moment of his life, saying that, God, not my will, but your will alone, Lord. Hallelujah. You know, church, he prayed, in fact, if possible, take away this cup. If possible, avoid this cross. Give me some other way so that I can achieve your purpose of redeeming the humanity. But still, ultimately, even though he had that desire, ultimately he prayed, not my will, Lord, your will. He was ready to take pain for, you know, the serving the will of God. He was ready to go through that suffering of the cross to serve the will of God. Dear church, that should be our attitude. Whether it is hard to follow or suffering involved or challenges involved, still we should be able to surrender our life with a greater determination and commitment to serve God's will. And God, Jesus himself showed us this example to us to follow God's will in our life. Listen very carefully. We are living in a world where we are exposed to so many things. When we see our neighbors doing something, or our colleagues are doing something, or our relatives are doing something, naturally we all have a desire to do the same thing. Somebody purchased a BMW and we also want a BMW. Somebody purchased a nice suit, we also want similar suit. That's a natural tendency for every human being. But let me encourage you, dear chum, we are not called to live according to the standards or trends of somebody else. Rather, we are called to make choices according to the will of God. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, right from the purchase that you are making, right from the time that you are spending, to your job, to your ministry, everything should be under the will of God. That's why every day we should ask, Lord, what is your will? Is it your will to purchase this? Is it your will to go here? Is it your will to have this relationship? Is it your will to have this job? Is it your will to continue this place as in this company? We need to continuously ask this question, Lord, is it your will? What is your will for me? If we don't ask that question to God and tune ourselves, I'm telling you, we will be just carried away with the people around us, trends around us, culture around us. That should not happen to us. As a Christian, we should always determine to see God's will. In my life, I have seen this, especially in Indian culture, we have this tendency more. We want to impress people, right? People, you go to a marriage, what is the ultimate concern for everyone? To impress everyone. To make sure that they are somebody, maybe at least little greater than others. That's a tendency, that's a culture that we see outside. But we are not supposed to carry it away with those kind of tendencies of this world. Rather, every choice, every decision, everything that we make in our personal life should be based on the will of God. How I please God with my choices, how I please God with my decision, that should be ultimate concern of our heart rather than pleasing everyone in this world. In everything in our life, we need to do God's will, dear child. And the third reason, so this is the principle by which we need to live on this earth. And the third reason why we should do God's will, and we need to, if we want to develop an intimate relationship with God, then we need to do God's will. Matthew chapter 12 verse number 50 says, whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. And Jesus is not talking about the physical, you know, mothers and sisters. Rather, he is talking here about the spiritual family, the close relationship with him. If you want to become part of his family, if you want to go closer to Jesus Christ, surely we need to do God's will. If we are not doing God's will, it is going to create a gap between us and God. It's going to create a disobedience in us. So intimacy is not an accident. Intimacy is a result of conscious obedience to the Lord. That's why God said, Jesus said, those who love me will obey my commandments. So without obeying God's will, without obeying God's commandment, we cannot have an intimacy. Sometimes we have a misunderstanding them. Even if we pray for 5 hours, or if I take 21 days fasting prayer, all of a sudden we can have an intimacy. Yes, it may help in some extent, but ultimately our obedience matters. Our life of our obedience towards the will of God matters a lot. And I mentioned to you, God has a personal intentions, will for every one of us. We need to seek that. We need to obey them so that we can develop a close relationship with God, an intimacy with God. So those who obey God's will have intimacy with God. They will grow closer and closer to God. And fourth reason why we should obey God's will, fourth reason, and if you want to do right decision in your life, if you want to make the best choice in your life, if you want to make something very perfect in your life, listen carefully. If you need to do God's will. Why I said, Romans chapter 12 verse number 2 says about the will of God like this: God's will is good, acceptable and perfect. Amen. Hallelujah. Dear church, we can take perfect choices, perfect decisions. We will not fail in making choices or making decisions if we are ready to listen God's voice and obey his will. When we do God's will, listen very carefully, you are making the right choice. You are making perfect decision. You are making the best decision. Hallelujah. It says here, good, acceptable and perfect. Hallelujah. And every one of us want to take right choices in our life, best decisions in our life. How we can do them? Follow the will of God. Listen carefully. We are human beings. Even if we have years of experience, even if we have a lot of knowledge, I want to tell you that still we have a limitation. But we have this God who planned our life every day carefully, even before we were born on this earth. If we ask him, he is going to show us right decision, right path, right choice, and we will ultimately succeed. Why I said that? Because we are not taking decision based on our mere knowledge. We are taking decision based on the will of God, based on God's, you know, superior knowledge, omniscient knowledge. So I want to encourage you, depend upon God. Let us follow his guidance. And let me just give you a simple warning here. I heard many people saying that God spoke to me. I felt so I did so. They completely ignore the rational aspect. They completely ignore the counsel of others. They completely ignore any other kind of confirmation for the will of God. Don't be just carried away. Little later I will tell you how to recognize God's will. It is not just I fell. We should have a clear conviction and guidance along with in our heart, and also others should recognize, especially people who are closer to, should be able to recognize, yes, this person is following God's will. So God's will is always good and best for us. That's why we should follow God's will. I want to just remind you here one simple point. And you know, sometimes when we ask God's will, he says no to us. How many times you heard no from the Lord? I heard so many times. You know, God's no is always best for us. We need to recognize that. If God says no, It's best for us because he could see something that we could not see. That's why he said no. If we follow that path, probably we will become like Balaam. What he did, he insisted God. God gave him no, but he crossed that. He insisted God. God just left him, and we know all the problems he made. So I want to encourage you, dear church, we should follow God's will ultimately. Even if it is no from the Lord, we should surrender to that no of God, because God's will is always best and perfect and good for each one of us. And fifthly, why this is matters, why God's will is matters. In God's will, we have protection and provision of God. If you follow God's will, I want to tell you that you are going to see God's protection as well as provision of God. God inspired Elijah to go and meet Ahab and say to him, there won't be any rain here. And we know there was no rain and there was no food in that land. And Elijah has to hide somewhere. Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 17 verse number 3 onwards, God asked him to go to Kerith Brook and hide there. And then he commanded ravens to bring bread for him. You see, when you follow God's will, God will protect you as well as God will provide for you. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why sometimes when we make decisions, we all have this concern, will I make a mess? Will I be God wrong? If you want to avoid, a mess in our life and enjoy God's continuous protection and provision of our life, we need to actually recognize God's will in our life. When we follow God's will, He will give you resources. Sometimes even God asks us to do impossible things. But if He asks us to do impossible things, I want to tell you that He will give you ability to do, and He will enable us supernaturally to do, and as well as He will give us resources to do that. Hallelujah. He will give us resources. Always I think God's will and Bill is on God. Amen. If it is God's will, Bill is on God, not on us. So He will provide the resources for each one of us. Amen. Lastly, why we need to follow God's will? Because it eternally matters. Hallelujah. Following God's will is eternally matters to each one of us. And Matthew chapter 7 verse number 21 says, no, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. So who will enter into the kingdom of God? Not everyone, dear church, those who do the will of God. The kingdom of God is all about the reign of God. Hallelujah. The will, wherever God's will is there, that's the kingdom of God. If you want to enter into the kingdom of God, then you need to follow the will of God. If you continuously read verse number 22 onwards, it looked like a judgment scenario where, people who prophesied in the name of Jesus, people who cast out the demons in the name of Jesus, people who did, miracles in the name of Jesus, they all came and stood before the Lord and knocking the door of heaven. But Jesus said, I do not know you. Leave. You know why? Because they didn't do will of God. Sometimes we all want glamorous ministry and glamorous experience, tremendous big experience, forgetting about doing the will of God. Dear church, we need both. We need obedience to the will of God, and we need experience and power. Hallelujah. Dear church, hallelujah. Why it is matters? Because if we don't follow the will of God, we will not enter into heaven. Yes, we have a privilege of having born again experience, but every born again believers, I mentioned just now, every born again believer should follow the will of God, because that's the way they will make sure that they will enter into the kingdom of God in heaven in the eternity. And Jesus said to these people who never did the will of God, He said to them, I do not know you. I told you, to develop intimacy, we need to do will of God. If God wants us to personally know, we need to do God's will. When we do God's will, God is going to recognize your name. God is going to recognize you. Otherwise, God will tell us, I do not know. So it matters in eternity. Doing God's will matters eternity. If we all are getting ready for the coming of the Lord, we need to do God's will. Okay, and I have few more minutes, and remaining minutes I will share how we can recognize God's will. How we can recognize God's will. Hallelujah. And first of all, we need to pray. And Matthew chapter 6 verse number 10 says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So Jesus himself asks us to pray for God's will to come on this earth. Hallelujah. If you want to know God's will, dear church, we need to pray. At Gethsemane, what Jesus did, he prayed for God's will to manifest. Hallelujah. Every one of us need to pray for God's will in our life. And then only we will be able to recognize God's will. And also that's the way we will make sure that God's will alone is happening in our life. Continuously we need to pray. Every day we need to pray God's will to take place. Hallelujah. Not our will, not demonic will, not anything else, but God's will to take place, because God's will is good and perfect for each one of us. Hallelujah. So pray for it. Secondly, if you want to recognize God's will, we need to understand inner convictions. I don't think I need to explain so much about this part, because we went through the training of hearing God and prophetical ministry a lot here. So we all know how to recognize God's will. But still, let me give you these reminders, inner convictions. So secondly, if you want to know God's will, recognize inner convictions in our life. And Romans chapter 8 verse number 16 says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So the Spirit of God communicates to our spirit. He tells to our spirit. He gives us certain check-ins in our heart. He gives us certain convictions within us, within our heart. He gives us certain kind of inner awareness in our heart. When we pray, when we walk with the Lord, Lord brings this kind of convictions in our spirit through the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. That's the way we recognize God's will. And Bible says in some place, God's Spirit stirred up people's heart to do certain things. So sometimes, that's why inner convictions coming through the stirring of our spirit sometimes. And Bible says, those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So leading of the Spirit comes to our spirit sometimes. And Paul says, I bound by the Spirit and go to Jerusalem. So that experience of that, the binding comes to our heart. Dear church, through different these kind of means, God brings inner convictions within our heart, what we should do in our life, what kind of decisions we need to make, and follow your inner voice, inner convictions. Thirdly, God's will reveals to us through scriptural confirmations. Hallelujah. Yes, moral will revealed to us, but when we want to make a personal, when we want to discern God's personal will for our life, he gives us confirmations through the scripture. Let me tell you, dear church, some of major decisions when I have taken, including marriage, including ministry, Lord has given me certain verses as a confirmation in my heart, and that gave me strength, that gave me a promise. Hallelujah. So God gives scriptural confirmation when we pray about certain things in our life. Psalms number 199 verse number 105 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. God uses his scriptures to guide us, lead us. And we know about Rhema word. When we read the Bible prayerfully, you know what happened? Certain verses will jump out from the Bible. It speaks to our heart. It gives us peace. It gives us certain direction. It gives us certain confirmation. So the scripture gives us confirmation within our heart about the will of God. Fourthly, godly counsel. Godly counsel. Dear church, I want to tell you, I am a person who receives so many counseling from the people. I can tell you from my experience, it gives us a clear clarity about God's path in our personal life. And Proverbs chapter 15 verse number 22 says, where there is no guidance, people fall, but in abundance of counselors, there is safety. Why you have parents, why you have a pastor, why you have brothers and sisters or somebody who is spiritually mature in your life to guide you, to help you. Dear children and youngsters, listen very carefully. You may not be able to make always the right choices in your life. That's why parents are there. Dear parents, listen very carefully. We need to pray for our children to recognize God's will. Hallelujah. We need to put this into their heart. They are not carried, they should not carried away with the trends of this world, desires of this world. Some of our children probably watch some movies and they want to become like the movie star. We should not allow that to happen to our children. We should tell our children that yes, they should recognize God's will. We should put the seed into their heart, and also we should give them freedom to recognize that, you know, God's will in their life. And dear parents and children, remember this thing: we are called to follow God's will. So godly counsel matters a lot to recognize God's will in our personal life. And I want to tell you, I can tell you, you know, so many experiences from this church. You know, I just said certain things mentioned to people that drastically change people's life. I witnessed it, and I'm glad to see that, because that particular moment probably God put some wisdom into my heart when I shared to that people, that person or that family. They followed it, they got benefit. I want to tell you that in godly counsel, we will see where God wants to, you know, direct us. And I always want to make sure this one point in my life, I don't want to take decisions so independently, though I will be I will take the responsibility of my own decision, and I will be the ultimate person to take the decision. But still, I want to take input from my parents, people who are in my life, who can give me the word, good counseling. So remember that we will be able to recognize God's direction and will through godly counseling. And fifthly, prophetical confirmation. And Acts chapter 13 verse number 2 says, while they were worshipping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and for Saul for the work to which I have called them. So here in this place you can see God is instructing, Holy Spirit is instructing, you know, a group of prophets to set apart Saul and Barnabas for ministry. And we know from the Bible very clear, much before this incident, God clearly spoke to Paul as well as Barnabas. They have a call. They have a ministry. Paul knew it. Barnabas knew it. But here, through the prophets, they got a confirmation about the will of God. So God confirms the will of God through the prophet. Let me just give you a warning here. You know, I already mentioned, we all have a capacity to listen God's voice. There are believers who run after the prophet. One prophet will say one thing, another prophet will say another thing, and they don't have their own call. They don't have their own way of listening God. I want to tell you that I said just confirmation. I didn't tell the prophet will reveal the will of God. God may use them, but I want to ultimately tell you that we need to recognize the personal will of God in our life, and through prophet, we only should look for a confirmation, not for an ultimate guidance. Hallelujah. So prophetical confirmation. And lastly, we can recognize God's will in our life, having the peace within us. When we pray, when we want to take a decision in our life, we get peace within our heart if it is will of God. Look at the scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 12 and 13. And when I came to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ, even though a door was open for me in the Lord, my spirit was not at rest. Then he says some reason. And then he went to Macedonia. So Paul came to preach in this place, and he got a big opportunity, wonderful opportunity to preach the gospel. But there was no peace within him. So he went to Macedonia. That's why gospel reached Europe and other places. Hallelujah. Otherwise, probably that place would still remain as a pagan, you know, place, Gentile place. But gospel reached them because of this. So Paul didn't get this peace. Look at this thing. He had a wonderful opportunity, but he didn't get the peace. So every opportunity is not from the will of God. Every opportunity is not from the Lord. That's why we need to recognize whether opportunities, open doors are from the Lord or not. Hallelujah. If it is from the Lord, we will have tremendous peace within our heart. God is a God of peace, and when we are in the will of God, we will enjoy that peace. Hallelujah. When we go out from the will of God, surely we will have disturbance within our heart. That's why, you know, I said, through the peace of God within our heart, we can recognize whether our choices are right or not, or our decisions are according to the will of God or not. Hallelujah. Let me just conclude here. Are you a person living according to the will of God? If you messed up with God's intentions for your life, you always have a chance to come by. Hallelujah. Some of us may be thinking that, yes, I missed God's will, but you have a chance to come by. Some of you may be thinking that I have 25 years or 30 years or 5 years of Christian life, and I am in 50s or 60s or 70s or 40s. I missed so many of my years. I could not actually recognize God's will. But I want to tell you that still you have an opportunity to recognize God's will in your life. I told you, God has a will for your future. God has a will for tomorrow. God has a will for, God has a plan for tomorrow in your life. So still you have an opportunity to come by and do God's will. I want to encourage all of you, you know, take a decision within your heart. No matter what you need to face, no matter what you have to go through, make a decision in your heart. I will do God's will alone. Like Jesus said, I have come to do God's will. The same way we should have a commitment. I am here to do God's will. And today, as I wind up this message, I want you to take a decision in your life. Rest of my life. Rest of my days on this earth, I will do God's will. I will work the companies where God is leading me. I will leave places where God is leading me. I will have only relationship with people whom God is leading into my life. And I will only, you know, use my money the way God instructing me to use my money. And I will only, you know, spend my time in things that God only instructing me. I want to encourage you, every areas in your life, bring under the will of God. As a born-again believers, as a children of God, God wants to see that we all follow God's will. Hallelujah. Shall we all close our eyes right now? No, we will come forward and sing this song, The Shepherd of My Soul. Hallelujah. As we sing this song, wherever you are, I want to ask you, sing this song as a prayer in your heart. As a prayer in your heart. Tell God, you are my shepherd. Please lead me, Lord. And if you are a person standing in a crossroad, need to take a crucial decision in your life, ask the Lord, Lord, show me your way, Lord. Show me your way, Lord Father. If you are a person never prayed for the will of God to manifest in your life, to happen in your life, make a commitment this morning, Lord, today onwards, I am going to pray. Every day, that's going to be my first priority, to pray for the will of God to come in my life. He's our shepherd. He's ready to lead us. Hallelujah. Let's sing together.
Shepherd of my soul, I give you full
control. Oh yes, Lord.
Wherever you may lead, I will
follow.
I have made a choice,
hallelujah,
to listen to your voice.
Wherever you may lead, I will go. Yes, church, how many of you say that? I only need your will, Lord. I only need your will, Lord. Your will alone. Your will only, Lord, Father, in my life. Let's sing once again.
Shepherd of my soul, I give you full control.
Yes, I'll give you full control.
Wherever you may lead,
I will follow.
I have made a choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lead, I will go. In the quiet pasture, by a gentle stream, The shepherd of my soul is by my side. Should I face a mighty mountain or a valley dark and deep, the shepherd of my soul be my guide.
Oh Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. If you are ready to follow, He is ready to lead you. He is ready. If you are ready to listen, He is ready to speak to you. Hallelujah. He is ready to just lead you through every situation if you are ready to follow Him. Make a commitment this morning. Here I am, Lord, surrendering my life for your will, Lord. Like Jesus prayed at Gethsemane, kneeling down, bowing down before the Father, asking His will. The same way can we do, not my will, Lord, but your will, Lord. Not my will, Lord, but your will, Lord. Hallelujah. Dear Father, I pray for everyone who is part of this worship right now. The Spirit of God, you speak to them. Speak to them right now. Help them to recognize things in their life that are not according to your will, Lord. Lord, our people may compile right now to your heart, to the center of your will, Lord. Hallelujah. Dear church, I want to ask you to make a choice right now. If Lord is showing in any areas in your life that is not according to His will, tell God right now, I am saying goodbye to this. I am saying goodbye to this. I like it, I love it, but I am going to say goodbye to this because I recognize this is not according to your will. Any of your habit, any of your choices, anything in your life, if you feel that is not according to God's will, right now, say goodbye to that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Surrender your life right now in a fresh way to the Lord. Saying that, Lord, here I am to do your will. Not my will, Lord, but your will. Lord, I ask you right now, release your guidance to people, Lord Father. Especially I pray for all people, all our youngsters who want to make career choices and also the choices with their life partners, Lord. Show them your way, Lord. Show them your way, Lord Father. We pray for our children, Lord Father. Even this young age, help them to recognize God's will, Lord Father. I pray for everyone who is part of this worship service, Lord. Speak to them right now. Show them your will, Lord Father. Show them your will, Lord Father. Show them your will, Lord Father. Hallelujah. I ask you, Lord, anyone is messed up with your will and struggling in their life, set them free right now, Lord Father. Let them come back to you right now. Let your mercy and grace be upon them right now. Let them compile right now. Hallelujah. Anything that holding them back right now, I break it in the name of Jesus. Let your people compile right now. Lord, I pray, give us determination, commitment, allow to do your will, Lord Father. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen.